BBC One, Ethel the Frog.
Good evening. On Ethel the Frog tonight, we look at violence, the violence of British gangland. Last Tuesday, a reign of terror was ended when the notorious Piranha brothers, Doug and Dinsdale, after one of the most extraordinary trials in British legal history, were sentenced to 400 years imprisonment for crimes of violence. Tonight, Ethel the Frog examines the rise to power of the Piranhas, the methods they used to subjugate rival gangs, and their subsequent tracking down and capture by the brilliant Superintendent Harry Snapper Organs of Q Division. Doug and Dinsdale Piranha were born, on probation, in this house in Kipling Road, Southwark, the eldest sons in a family of 16. Their father, Arthur Piranha, a scrap metal dealer and TV quizmaster, was well known to the police and a devout Catholic. In January 1928, he had married Kitty Malone, an up-and-coming East End boxer. Doug was born in February 1929 and Dinsdale 2 weeks later, and again a week after that. Their next-door neighbour was Mrs. April Simnel.
Kipling Road were a typical sort of East End street. People were in and out of each other's houses with each other's property all day long. They were a cheery lot, though.
Was it a terribly violent area?
Oh! Yes, cheerful and violent. I remember Doug was very keen on boxing till he hurt the walk, and then he took up putting the boot in the groin. Oh, he was very interested in that. His mother used to have such trouble getting him to come in for his tea. He'd be out there, putting his little boot in, you know, bless him. But, you know, kids were very different then. They didn't have their heads filled with all this Cartesian dualism.
At the age of 15, Doug and Dinsdale started attending the Ernest Pythagoras Primary School in Clerkenwell.
You taught the Piranha brothers English. What do you remember most about them? Anthony, finally.
When the Piranhas left school, they were called up, but were found by an army board to be too mentally unstable, even for national service. Denied the opportunity to use their talents in the service of their country, they began to operate what they called the operation. They would select a victim and then threaten to beat him up if he paid them the so-called protection money. 4 months later, they started another operation, which they called the other operation. In this racket, they selected another victim and threatened not to beat him up if he didn't pay them. 1 month later, they hit upon the other operation. In this, the victim was threatened that if he didn't pay them, they would beat him up. This, for the Piranha brothers, was the turning point.
Doug and Dinsdale Piranha now formed a gang, which they called The Gang, and used terror to take over nightclubs, billiard halls, gaming casinos, and racetracks. When they tried to take over the MCC, they were, for the only time in their lives, slid up a treat. As their empire spread, however, we in Q Division were keeping tabs on their every movement by reading the colour supplements.
A small-time operator who fell foul of Dinsdale Piranha was Vince Snetterton Lewis.
One day I was sitting at home, threatening the kids, and I looked out of the hole in the wall, and I saw this tank drive up, and one of Dinsdale's boys gets out, and he comes up all nice and friendly-like, and says Dinsdale wants to have a talk with me. So he chains me to the back of the tank and takes me for a scrape round to Dinsdale's. And Dinsdale's there in the conversation pit with Doug and Charles Paisley, the baby crusher, and a couple of film producers, and a man they called Kierkegaard, who just sat there biting the heads off whippets. And Dinsdale said, "Oh, you've been a naughty boy, Clement." And he splits me nostrils open and saws me leg off and pulls me liver out. And I said, "My name's not Clement." And then he loses his temper and nails my head to the floor.
He nailed your head to the floor?
At first, yeah.
Another man who had his head nailed to the floor was Stig O'Tracy.
Stig, I've been told that Dinsdale Piranha nailed your head to the floor.
No! No, never! Never! He was a smashing bloke. He used to give his mother flowers and that. He was like a brother to me.
But the police have film of Dinsdale actually nailing your head to the floor.
Oh, yeah, well, he did that, yeah.
Why?
Well, he had to, didn't he? I mean, be fair, there was nothing else he could do. I mean, I had transgressed the unwritten law.
What had you done?
Well, he never told me that. But he gave me his word that it was the case, and that's good enough for me with old Dinsy. I mean, he didn't want to nail my head to the floor. I had to insist. He wanted to let me off. There's nothing Dinsdale wouldn't do for you.
And you don't bear him any grudge?
A grudge? Old Dinsy, he was a real darling.
I understand he also nailed your wife's head to a coffee table. Isn't that right, Mrs. O'Tracy?
Oh! Yeah, well, he did do that, yeah. He was a cruel man, but fair.
Vince, after he nailed your head to the floor, did you ever see him again?
Yeah. After that, I used to go around to his flat every Sunday lunchtime to apologise, and we'd shake hands, and then he'd nail my head to the floor.
Every Sunday?
Yeah. But he was very reasonable about it. I mean, one Sunday, when my parents were coming round for tea, I asked him if he'd mind very much not nailing my head to the floor that week, and he agreed, and just screwed my pelvis to a cake stand.
The only friend I ever had.
I wouldn't hear a word against him.
Lovely fella.
Clearly, Dinsdale inspired tremendous loyalty and terror amongst his business associates. But what was he really like?
I walked out with Dinsdale on many occasions and found him a most charming and erudite companion. He was wont to introduce one to many eminent persons, celebrated American singers, members of the aristocracy, and other gang leaders.
Was there anything unusual about him?
I should say not. Dinsdale was a perfectly normal person in every way. Except inasmuch as he was convinced that he was being watched by a giant hedgehog, and he referred to as Spiny Norman.
How big was Norman supposed to be?
Normally, he was wont to be about 12 feet from snout to tail, but when Dinsdale was very depressed, Norman could be anything up to 800 yards long. When Norman was about, Dinsdale would go very quiet, and his nose would swell up, and his teeth would start moving about, and he'd become very violent and claim that he'd laid Stanley Baldwin. Dinsdale was a gentleman. What's more, he knew how to treat a female impersonator.
It's easy for us to judge Dinsdale Piranha too harshly. After all, he only did what most of us simply dream of doing. I'm sorry. After all, a murderer is only an extroverted suicide. Dinsdale was a loony, but he was a happy loony.
I was terrified of him. Everyone was terrified of Doug. I've seen grown men pull their own heads off rather than see Doug. Even Dinsdale was frightened of Doug.
What did he do?
He used sarcasm. All the old tricks, dramatic irony, metaphor, bathos, puns, parody, litotes, and satire.
By a combination of violence and sarcasm, the Piranha brothers, by February 1966, controlled London and the southeast. In February, though, Dinsdale made a big mistake.
Latterly, Dinsdale had become increasingly worried about Spiny Norman. He had come to the conclusion that Norman slept in an aeroplane hangar at Luton Airport.
And so, on February the 22nd, 1966, at Luton Airport... Even the police began to sit up and take notice.
The Piranhas realised they'd gone too far and that the hunt was on. They went into hiding and I decided on a subtle approach, viz. Some form of disguise, as the old helmet and boots were a bit of a giveaway. Luckily, my years with Bristol Rep stood me in good stead as I assumed a bewildering variety of disguises. I tracked them to Cardiff, posing as the Reverend Smiler Egret. Hearing they'd gone back to London, I assumed the identity of a pork butcher, Brian Stokes. On my arrival in London, I discovered they had returned to Cardiff. I followed as Gloucester from King Lear. Acting on a hunch, I spent several months in Buenos Aires as Blind Pew, returning through the Panama Canal as a Ratty in Toad of Toad Hall. Back in Cardiff, I relived my triumph as Sancho Panza in Men of La Mancha, which the Bristol Evening Post described as a glittering performance of rare perception, although the Bath Chronicle was less than enthusiastic. In fact, it gave me a right panning. I quote,
As for the performance of Superintendent Harry's snapper organs as Sancho Panza, the audience were bemused by his high-pitched Welsh accent and intimidated by his abusive ad-libs.
Western Daily News said,
Sancho Panza, Mr. Organs, spoilt an otherwise impeccably choreographed rape scene by his unscheduled appearance and persistent cries of, what's all this?
Never mind, snapper love, you can't win them all.
True, Constable, could I have my eyeliner, please?
Oh, telegram for you, love.
Oh, hello. I bet it's from Binky.
Those flowers are for Sergeant Lauderdale from the gentleman waiting outside.
Oh, good.
30 yes. seconds, Superintendent.
Oh, blimey, I'm on. Is me at straight, Constable?
Oh, it's fine.
Right, here we go then, Hawkins.
Oh, mad, Superintendent.
Good luck, then.
Read all about it. Piranha Brothers escape.
Dinsdale. 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 Dinsdale.